My name is Andrew, and I'm a clinical mental health counselor at ACC. My colleagues and I, with the help of ACC TV, would like to give a few helpful tips on managing daily stressors we all encounter during this pandemic. Many of us are working from home or schooling from home. However, psychotherapist Esther Perel puts it this way: we are working with home. We are with our families, our children, partners, parents, siblings, roommates, and we're inhabiting the roles of the parent, the teacher, the student, the friend, the colleague, the boss, all at the same time, and often from the same chair. Perel goes on to say that we're accustomed to having a different attire during different times of the day, and we're usually in a different space for the multiple activities in which we engage. When we go to work or school, we dress a certain way. And when we return home or move from one place to another, we have a different way of being. And our activities are demarcated and outlined in time and in space. And right now, that's all awash. You may be watching children from home, homeschooling children, trying to attend school, trying to have a meeting, all while dressed from the waist up. This can be chaotic, draining, and cause fatigue. It's our hope these tips will help establish and foster emotional structure and to let you know help is available while attending ACC.
My name is Tracy Long, and I'm one of the clinical counselors here at Austin Community College. The mental health tip that I bring to you today is to pay attention to your body. We as individuals are aware that our body responds to changes in the environment, but we may be confused about what causes these responses and how they occur. In situations that are perceived as stressful or frightening, either mentally or physically, an automatic physiological reaction occurs, also referred to as the flight or fight response. The response is triggered by the release of hormones that prepares the body to either stay and deal with the threat or run away to safety. The body also goes through many physical changes in response to stress or anxiety. Some of the common physiological responses are rapid heart rate and breathing, sweating, trembling, pale or flushed face. Some common physical symptoms are stomach aches or problems, headaches or other aches and pains, or body tension, chronic fatigue or sleep disturbances, and even immune system disturbances, such as catching more colds. However, when the perceived threat is gone, the system will return to normal function via the relaxation response. So here are a few ways to practice self-care in order to better manage symptoms of stress or anxiety. First, self-monitor for signs of stress and trauma. Second, restore the well that is you, meaning take time to do the things that you enjoy. Third, let others replenish the well by seeking help when you need it. And then fourth, stay spiritually grounded. This may include prayer and or mindfulness. Again, be intentionally kind and gentle to yourself and those around you, especially loved ones. And remember, laugh more.
My name is Hani Hernandez. I'm part of the ACC counseling team. This is a time to be unapologetic. We often live in a culture of having to say, I'm sorry for every little thing. Yes, being accountable for one's actions is important, but there is a difference between being accountable for one's behaviors and actions versus feeling like you have to apologize for every little thing that goes wrong. Take a step back and self-assess. How often are you offering apologies? Ask yourself the following: am I apologizing because I can't make sense of what went wrong? Am I apologizing because I have difficulty expressing my feelings? Am I apologizing because I am trying to avoid conflict? Am I apologizing because I have to versus I want to? Am I apologizing because being the nicer person is the price to pay to keep my relationships afloat? Am I apologizing from a place of fear? If your responses to most of these questions is a yes, take a moment to consider the things you don't need to apologize for, such as taking time for yourself, setting realistic goals, creating a healthy boundaries and sticking to them, having a different point of view, being yourself and transparent about what you need, and when you are ready to become less unapologetic, you will understand that it is not rude to seek solitude, even during quarantine. Moments or periods of healthy solitude are essential parts of personal growth. Solitude can grant us the opportunity to self-reflect without the common distractions of the world, which can sometimes overshadow the very essence of being. And by being, I am referring to the authentic you, who you are when no one is watching, who you are when no one is judging, who you are when your thoughts, feelings, reactions belong to you and only you. We forget at times that disconnecting is also a part of connecting. Solitude creates a space of intimacy within the self that allows us to recognize when an offering to connect is being presented. Explore the possibilities, claim your nook and make it your own. Put those headphones on and disconnect mentally, simply by closing your eyes when physical separation is not possible. Express to those close to you the need and importance for solitude. Remember that the relationship you have with yourself will impact every relationship you encounter. Note that being rude to yourself is rude. Doing all these things together will be hard and challenging, but most important for maintaining mental health wellness. Thank you for taking the time to listen in today.
If you'd like more information on ACC's clinical counseling services, please visit our website at austincc.edu/counseling. Our team of mental health professionals are here to help you navigate the many obstacles of life, especially during this pandemic. Thank you for watching.